Hello and welcome to another episode of the COE Lecture Series, where we bring you lectures, discussions, and workshops on a variety of topics related to the broad fields of education. Today we bring you the most recent entry in the Ramsey Lecture Series. Dr. Russell R. Pate, a nationally recognized expert and scholar on physical activity, is a professor of exercise science at the University of South Carolina. His topic, Policies for Promotion of Physical Activity and Obesity Prevention in Youth.
Kirk, thank you very, very much. I can't tell you how honored I am to be here this afternoon and to be invited to deliver the Ramsey Lecture. As Kirk alluded to, I feel that our program at USC and the program here at Georgia have enjoyed many wonderful and very productive connections and collaborations over the years, and I can certainly tell you that I value enormously the relationships that I've had with colleagues here at UGA, and I'm going to mention just two. One is Kirk, and as he mentioned, we've been on pretty parallel career paths together here at Southeastern Universities for a long time, and I've been honored to work with Kirk in many different projects and settings over the years, including the FitnessGram Advisory Committee, which we both toiled away on for a long time, and I hope it made a contribution to. I'll also mention Dr. Rod Dishman of the faculty here, who's been kind enough to work with our research team at USC for many years, and I don't mind telling you that I think our group's work has been just enormously advanced by the contribution that he's made and the considerable sacrifice and contribution that's meant. And I think he knows that his work with our group means a lot to me, but I don't often get the opportunity to say it publicly, so I'm very pleased that I can do that today. I have just one other preliminary comment, and that is I know many of you are students in the program here, and I want to tell you, sometimes you say you had to get 100 miles from home before you become an expert, and I'm over 100 miles from home, so I qualify as an expert for at least a minute or two here. You folks have a wonderful opportunity. This is a great program. And I think I know a little bit about the programs around the country. I'd like to think ours at USC is a good one. But the program here at Georgia is a great program, and you're fortunate to have access to it, and I commend you for taking advantage of it. So I'm honored to be here. I'm going to talk to you about primarily about policies to increase physical activity in children. But today it's hard to talk about that issue without getting to it through the issue of obesity, which of course has garnered so much attention over the last decade. You all know we're in the midst of an obesity epidemic, and I'm going to bet that some of you come at this issue maybe more from the dietary side than from the physical activity side, although I think today I'm probably in many ways preaching to the choir, but I'm going to tell you what I believe as a way of starting this off, and then I'm going to explain along the way why I feel this way and what I think we ought to do about it. I think we have an obesity epidemic today primarily because physical activity has declined tremendously in our society. I think that decline in physical activity and the decline in energy expenditure that comes with it has not been fully compensated by a decline in energy intake. I don't know whether we eat more or less today as a society than we did 10 years ago, but I know we eat a lot less today than we did 100 years ago and probably 50 years ago, and I'm going to bet 20 years ago. Now, more recently than that, I'm not positive. But I'm going to tell you right now that if our society eventually succeeds in conquering this obesity epidemic that we're currently afflicted by, I believe it'll be because we will have increased our physical activity levels. I don't think there is a snowball's chance in Athens in August that we're going to diet our way out of this. I just don't believe it. And that's not to say that the dietary side of the issue is anything other than very important. It is. And we have lots of important changes to make on that side, But I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to have to deal with the physical activity side of this issue if we're going to conquer it. So I'm going to take a few minutes here to explain why I feel that way and what I think we need to do about it. There's a lot of good science out there, I think, that documents the health benefits of physical activity in people in general and kids in particular. But it is my view, and I did have a chance to speak earlier today with some graduate students here, and I said this to them, great data alone is not going to change the world around this issue. We're going to have to, in my view, identify public policies that will be effective and that can be implemented and that are in fact implemented in a way that change our communities in ways that modify the way we live. And so I think our field, as a field, while we continue to do the science that's gotten us to this point, and there's lots more of it to do, I think has to think about how we're going to go about translating the findings of the work that we've done up to this point to action. And I think if we're honest with ourselves, we've not been terribly effective yet at moving the dial, at changing population levels of physical activity, and we need to figure out how to do that. And I think that implementing policies in an effective manner is a requirement if we're going to be successful. So that's where I'm heading. Kids benefit from high levels of physical activity, and while I think we do need to learn more about the details here, I think there's substantial evidence to support that. I had the opportunity to serve with Dr. Dishman on the Physical Activity Guidelines Advisory Committee, that the report of which informed the physical activity guidelines, the first federal physical activity guidelines that were released in 2008 by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. And my particular role on that committee was to work with the review of the evidence regarding the relationship between physical activity and health in children and adolescents. And the panel's conclusion was that there's strong evidence that higher levels of physical activity improve fitness, cardiorespiratory endurance, and muscular fitness, is associated with more favorable body composition, improved bone health, improved cardiovascular and metabolic health biomarkers, and that there was moderate evidence to support a relationship with reduced symptoms of anxiety and depression. So I think there are very good reasons for us to be concerned about whether or not our kids are adequately physically active. The guideline was released subsequent to the production of that report, and the guideline for children and adolescents can be summarized by saying kids should be physically active at least a moderate intensity for an hour a day. Now, there are some fine points, and within that hour a day, kids should be regularly involved in exercise of vigorous intensity that's likely to produce improvements in fitness, and they should also regularly engage in resistance exercise and in bone loading exercise as well. But the take home is an hour a day. Do they get it? The answer is no. Kids need more physical activity than they typically get in order to meet that guideline. And this has been studied in a number of different ways. Of course, the CDC manages a surveillance system called the Youth Risk Behavior Survey. It's administered to high school age students in the US odd numbered years. These are self-report data. And if you ask boys and girls high school age whether or not they think they get an hour of physical activity per day, and I can tell you with some considerable confidence that I don't think they really know, but they have some sense of their own activity levels, and not that many of them say that they believe they're getting that much exercise, and they I think pretty clearly are not. Of course, there's been a tremendous development in our field in the last 15 or so years with the advent of accelerometry as an objective measure of physical activity. This first was used primarily as a research tool and is now being much more widely used as an instrument in surveillance systems, including NHANES, the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey. We've used it in a number of research studies as well, and I'm going to show you some data from a study that we were involved in for over a period of several years with universities at several other locations around the country. The study was called TAG, Trial of Activity in Adolescent Girls, and for the baseline measurement, we put accelerometers on about 1,600 girls at six different locations around the U.S., which are listed here. They were all closely connected to the participating universities in this study. And we measured, of course, quite a number of variables. But amongst them, we had the girls wear the accelerometers for a week. We ended up with six complete days of data. The data were reduced in 30-second intervals. And this is the take-home from all of that. This is the time spent by these girls, on average, at various intensities of exercise. Now, the big blue sector on the right is time spent not moving at all. And you can see that that's over half of the observed time. And then the green sector, which is most of the rest of the pie, is light activity, which is movement in the, you know, 1-2 met range, 2 met, probably two, not more than 3 mets. The little white sector at the top is moderate intensity physical activity, about 18 minutes a day. And then the little narrow sector is vigorous, which was about 5 minutes per day. So you can add 18 and 5, and it's around 23 minutes or so of moderate to vigorous physical activity per day, which of course doesn't get you terribly close to 60 minutes. And in truth, very, very few girls in the TAG sample, these were sixth grade girls across those locations, actually met that 60-minute guideline. So, you know, I'm not going to come over to Athens today and tell you that I'm absolutely convinced that 60-minute guideline is the right one, but I think there's reasonable evidence to support it. I think it's the best we have right now in the way of a target. And if you do attach credibility to that guideline, not a lot of American kids are probably meeting that standard right now. This is the percentage that met the standard in the TAG sample, and you can sort of redefine the operational definitions of these standards in different ways to kind of get the answer that you want. But the one I like the best, because I think it's the best supported and defended in the methodology in this study, is the little white bar on the left for the 60-minute guideline. So you can see very, very few kids in this sample met that 60-minute guideline. So what have we gotten for that? Well, I think that that is a big part of, not the only reason by any means, but I think it's a big part of the reason that we've seen the trend that we have seen over recent decades for the prevalence of overweight and obesity in our society. And there's not anybody in this room this afternoon that doesn't know that this has happened and that it's a problem. So I'm not going to spend time trying to convince you that this is a concern. It is. And we need to figure out what to do about it. Now, I've already told you what I think, which is that low and inadequate levels of physical activity are an important underlying factor in the development of overweight. But I'm the first to say we need better evidence to support that conclusion, and I think we are beginning to get it. Now, I'm going to take a little bit of an excursion off to the side here for a second, just make a point that I think is critical here. Treatment of overweight is a pretty depressing pursuit. It's not that it never works. It does occasionally. But you know as well as I do that the odds of a substantially overweight person losing weight and maintaining that weight loss in the long term is low. I think the only realistic answer to this problem is prevention, and I think there's every reason to believe that prevention can work. And I don't have time today to kind of explain all the reasons why I think that, but I have a lot more optimism about the ultimate effectiveness of interventions that are aimed at preventing this problem than I do confidence in interventions that are aimed at treating it after it's been established. So I think we need to understand as much as we can based on prospective, longitudinal, observational studies, just what is it that explains the development of overweight over time, right? So my working hypothesis is that people who are highly active and stay highly active are less likely, substantially less likely, to become overweight than people who are less active. Now, that hypothesis is probably not going to be terribly surprising to anybody in this room. I think it's intuitive, just based on our experience. That doesn't mean that I hypothesize that everybody who's highly active will be lean, skinny over time. But I think the odds of people who are highly active and stay that way becoming overweight or obese is low. That's my hypothesis. So what are the data that support that? Well, there are some adult data. These are data from a large ongoing epidemiologic study, the CARDIA study, over 3,500 young adults that were followed through young adulthood. And these data basically support my contention that the more active groups track lower in terms of their BMI, change in BMI over time. Doesn't mean everybody's, at a terribly low BMI, but the more active groups track lower over a sizable period of observation, in this case 20 years. These are data from a study that our group at USC has had some association with that's based in the UK. It's an ALSPAC study, which is a very large birth cohort study in Bristol, England, where mothers and kids have been followed from birth. They're actually getting ready to have the 21-year celebration in next month. So they've followed these young people now from birth to age 21. And they have measured a lot of stuff on these people, and they have very good body composition data. And when these kids got sort of up into 10, 12 years old, they started putting accelerometers on them, and so we got good physical activity data as well. And so we need a bunch more ALSPAC studies, and I'll say that they're better in Europe at designing and conducting these long-term longitudinal studies on young people than we are in the U.S. We seem to have a hard time getting these things done here, but we need them, and we need more of this sort of thing. But I think this ALSPAC study is really a tremendous resource. So I'm going to show you some data for over 4,000 kids that were 12 years old when they first wore the accelerometers and had body composition measured by DEXA, and then were followed up 2 years later. And basically what they found is that physical activity level at the 12-year baseline did predict change in percent body fat over the next 2 years, with more active kids gaining less fat mass during that period of time. This study has followed up again on these kids 2 years later, and there's a paper that's in review now that essentially shows the same thing further out in terms of following up on these kids. One other study that's in the literature was done in this done in the U.S., and this is a work of Kathy Jans at the University of Iowa with the Iowa Bone Study, where they've been following a bunch of kids for a long time. They're primarily monitoring for development of bone mass, but they've looked at body composition, fat mass by DEXA assessment, and measurement of physical activity, objectively by accelerometry, and they get a pretty similar picture, which is moderate to vigorous physical activity at age 5, predicted fat mass at age 8 and 11, the more active kids associated with a lower fat mass at follow-up. So, I'm not here to tell you that I think this book is closed and that the case has been made and that we don't need to learn more about this. We do. But I think there are data in the literature that basically support the hypothesis that higher levels of physical activity sustained over time are associated with avoidance of excessive weight gain. We need to keep working on this. There is more, certainly a need for replication and better data here, but I'm not going to pretend that there aren't data that support the hypothesis, because I think there are. So my point would be that there's evidence that lots of it, that it's better for kids to be more active than sedentary, and that one of the benefits of maintaining that higher level of activity is avoidance of excessive weight gain. I've never been very attracted to the idea that we ought to sit back in the lab or in our offices and try to make the body of knowledge perfect before we act on it. So I think we can double task here. I think we can argue that we need better research and do that research, and at the same time advocate for change in the society that's consistent with the body of knowledge as it exists today. And that body of knowledge may change next week, next year, 5 years from now, and if so, we may need to change some of our approaches. But I don't think we're suddenly going to find that physical activity, higher levels of physical activity, aren't really important to kids, and I really don't think we're going to find that that physical activity is unimportant to weight gain and avoidance of overweight and obesity. So I think we can, with some confidence, be about the business of figuring out what to do about this. So a number of groups have, over the last few years, advanced some policies that are aimed at promoting physical activity in kids. And sometimes these have been developed and presented in the context of preventing childhood obesity. Kirk mentioned that I have served for several years on an Institute of Medicine panel that has produced a series of reports that are collectively aimed at identifying and recommending policies that are intended to prevent childhood obesity. And the first report released by this group was very comprehensive, and it was called Health and the Balance. If you haven't seen this, you may want to take a look at it on the IOM website. It's not hard to find. It is organized into these 10 sets of recommendations, and I certainly don't have time to talk about all of them, but you can see that this is very comprehensive, and I'm going to just cherry pick a few of the recommendations that are most of the more specific to physical activity elements in this report. Part of the story here, of course, is that there's not any magic bullet. That we're probably going to have to attack this issue on multiple fronts, in multiple settings and sectors of our society, and that I think really in a lot of ways is the primary message of this Health and the Balance report. But one of the recommendations that I emphasize is that we do need to make this a national priority. I don't think there's a whole lot of likelihood that we're going to make the changes that we'll need to make without leadership. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm a public health guy. I'm not trained in public health. I trained in exercise physiology, but I've been working in a school of public health for quite a long while, and I've sort of, I guess, morphed into somebody that really identifies with what public health does. And I don't mind saying we need to spend some money. If we want a healthy society, I'm not the least bit disinclined to say that there are times when we have to invest. That said, I don't think national leadership always means just spend money on it. I think part of it is drawing attention to the problem, reallocating resources that may already be committed somewhere else, mobilize new resources that may be available out there and not yet committed. But I do think we need national leadership. And, you know, I'll have to say that Mrs. Obama, clearly with her Let's Move campaign, has provided leadership, drawn great attention. I'm not going to tell you that I'm a huge fan of everything that program has done and hasn't done, but I admire the fact that there has been an attempt to provide national leadership. It's going to have to go beyond one presidential administration. This is going to take a sustained effort, and I hope that there will be national and federal leadership there for a long time. We need it at the state and local levels as well, and it's a very patchwork situation in this country right now. There's some states where there has been quite a lot of focus on the childhood obesity issue and related issues, and others where there hasn't been much at this point. The report calls for changes in the built environment, and it calls on local governments, private developers, and community groups to expand physical activity opportunities by improving the infrastructure in our communities that facilitate or support physical activity, or at least avoid creating barriers that prevent people from being physically active. I live 3 hours down the road. Where I live is not that different than where you live. And let's face it, in the Southeast, for a long time, it was developer heaven. You know, we just sort of let them go and build neighborhoods however they wanted to build them. And so what we've now got are an awful lot of neighborhoods with no sidewalks and not much infrastructure that facilitates physical activity. We're now kind of coming back through and trying to retrofit, but it's expensive and it's going to take time. But there is change, and I'm encouraged by it, and I think we need to support that trend. But we're digging out of a big hole that we created for ourselves. A lot of my group's work has been in schools, and I certainly believe that schools have got a big responsibility. I don't think schools alone are going to solve these problems, but I think schools can really help. And schools should provide, according to this report, and I agree with it, a consistent environment that's conducive to regular physical activity. Our groups learned the hard way, and other groups have certainly seen the same thing, that schools can be awfully sedentary places where kids don't move very much, but they aren't all that way. Some schools have kids where they do seem to move quite a lot, and we need to understand better than we do right now the factors that differentiate between those types of schools. I support the idea that if kids need 60 minutes of physical activity per day on a school day, they probably need to get at least half of that while they're there at school. And they don't right now. We have data that shows they get about half that. So I think schools won't solve the whole problem, but they can they can certainly make a bigger contribution than is true now. we have to figure out a way to influence the home environment. Parents should promote regular physical activity for their kids. They should regulate kids' access to sedentary pursuits, beyond reasonable limits. The American Academy of Pediatrics has a guideline that gets cited a lot that kids shouldn't watch TV for more than 2 hours a day. Kids below the age of two shouldn't watch TV at all, but most of them do, and millions and millions of kids watch a lot more than 2 hours of TV per day. And, interestingly to me at least, TV watching time hasn't really changed very much as we've layered on top of it video games and computers and text messaging and, on and on and on. So it's a lot of times, I'll be honest with you, it feels like we're swimming upstream, that our efforts to increase physical activity in kids are, we're sort of sometimes being overwhelmed by these huge societal developments that have the effect of pulling kids away from physical activity or in a way, creating barriers to their being active. The American Heart Association has spoken to these issues and specifically focused on schools with a report that provided a set of recommendations about how schools can promote activity in kids. And I'm going to come back to PE in a while here, but this set of recommendations said that states should hold schools accountable for physical education programs that meet national standards in terms of time of exposure. And what I really want to emphasize with you is they should include physical education in their core accountability systems, and no state out of 50 does that now. Okay, the school report cards, call them whatever you want to call them. You know, every state's got its own system. At this point, no state really holds their schools accountable for the provision of high-quality physical education. And I personally think we're going to have a tough time changing physical education at the national level until we can get it into the core accountability systems that are used to evaluate school performance. Promoting active transport to and from school, I think, is a tremendous opportunity. I spoke with the graduate students earlier today about this one. I think it's a huge opportunity. We've got a big social norm to turn around because this was, of course, common at one time, and it's not so common anymore. In fact, it's uncommon. I'll show you a little later. My group has worked a great deal in preschools over the last decade, and this is actually quite an opportunity, I think, because preschools have been largely unregulated in this country beyond, you know, basic safety standards and so on. But that's changing rapidly right now, and I don't have time to talk with you today about it, but lots of states are developing new guidelines for diet and physical activity in preschools, and I think we've got a little window here where I think there is a chance to effect some real change in child development centers. Higher education's got a huge responsibility. If we want to change physical education and we want to change how the schools operate, we've got to change how we prepare the people who go into the schools to do the work there. And you know, sometimes I'm struck by how much inertia there is in the system. You know, it is just, it seems to be so hard to change some of these things. But, you know, in my more cynical moments, I sort of look at what's going on in the schools, and I say, this hadn't changed since 1955. And you know, we've got a system there that was kind of put in place at that time after World War II. And I'll tell you, getting that to change is just not easy. We've got state, you know, guidelines and regulations, curricular mandates that were put there a long, long time ago. We're still training teachers to deliver that form of physical education and other school programming, and you know, it's just hard to change it. On a more positive note, though, I was thrilled to learn recently that AFERD, you know, the American Alliance for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance, has launched a new initiative that is, I think, providing a certificate for school physical activity coordinators, which is really sort of a broader approach designed to put people in the schools who are prepared to think broadly about how kids can be more physically active when they're in the school setting. So maybe things are changing. National Physical Activity Plan, Kirk mentioned in his introduction that I've spent a lot of time in the last few years working on this, and the plan is organized around 8 societal sectors. It was produced by a coalition of about 20 national organizations that came together to create a strategic plan for increasing physical activity in the U.S., and the sectors include education, public health, not-for-profit organizations, transportation, urban design and community planning, mass media, healthcare, business and industry, and parks, recreation, fitness, and sports. And I don't have time to go through all of that, of course, but I'll give you a little Whitman sampler here of some of the strategies that are included in the national plan. There are over 250 of them in total, but one in the education sector is provide access to and opportunities for high-quality, comprehensive physical activity programs anchored by physical education, which I kind of like that phrasing. I didn't write that, but I like the way that reads. Ensure that the programs are physically active, inclusive, safe, and developmentally and culturally important. And then develop and implement state and school district policies requiring school accountability. There it is again. Strongly endorse this one for the quality and quantity of physical education and physical activity programs. Now, I'm going to conclude this afternoon by telling you some things I would do, you know, and sort of what I did was sort of sit back and think about what I think the literature says, what my gut feeling is. If somebody made me, you know, king of the world for a month and I could change anything I wanted to change about these issues, what would I do? And so I'm going to tell you. And I'm not going to say that every one of these recommendations is deeply evidence-based. I'd like to think they're all evidence-informed, if that's fudging a little bit here. I wish the evidence were more extensive for some of these recommendations, but these are some things that I would do, and they're not necessarily in any priority order here. I think we need to demand high-quality physical education. And the word is demand. I think we need to demand high-quality physical education, and I don't think there is any reason why we shouldn't get it. My roots, personal roots, go way back. I'm a proud undergraduate physical education major. I think the field has enormous value and potential, and I think it's unrealized way too often. As I told the group earlier today, you know, if you get out in the schools and you see a great PE program, you'd want your kid to have that. You know, when it's good, it's wonderful. It just isn't good very often. And it's because we tolerate it. We, the society, tolerates it. And I think we should not. We're paying for it. We ought to demand high-quality programs. And if we did, I think that's what we'd get. And there's evidence that it can work. The group in Texas and around the country that did the CATCH studies, I think I've lost my figures here for some reason, but I think I don't need them. It's been demonstrated over and over again that if you intervene with physical education teachers to train them to deliver an approach to physical activity that emphasizes higher levels of physical activity, you can get that. We just don't do that on a systemic basis. Second, I think we need to shift the social norm so that many more children walk or ride their bikes to school. There's absolutely no reason why that shouldn't happen. It used to be the case in this society not that long ago. It isn't that way anymore. One of my most recent PhD students studied this issue for his dissertation. John and the other students that he coerced into helping him with this stood in front of elementary schools in Columbia and directly observed how the kids got there in the morning, and they were back there in the afternoon, and they observed how they left in the afternoon. And so it wasn't self-report. They watched it and coded it and logged it, and it was about 3% of the kids in these elementary schools, which I think are pretty typical, actually walked or rode bike to school. And it doesn't have to be that way. And there are other countries in the world where it isn't that way, you know, where the norm is kids walk or ride bike to school. And I'm not naive enough to think that that's going to happen here in every school for obvious reasons. But it could be much more the norm than it is now. Next, I think we need to demand access to high-quality after-school programs. As I told the group earlier today, I think that 3-6 time block in the afternoon is a tremendous opportunity that too often gets squandered. And I think that, there was a time, again, when I think the social norm was when the bell went off at 3 o'clock, what was supposed to happen was kids were supposed to go out that door, go outside and be active for a good long time. And that's just not so much the case anymore. We've got a lot of kids in structured after-school programs when they're at the elementary school age, And those programs run the gamut from their warehousing them and letting them watch videos to their very nice programs that provide a lot of physical activity. And I think the time has come for communities to really focus on what the children in those communities are doing during that after-school time block. And I think this is really a time of day and time of the week when there's a tremendous opportunity to provide kids with a real dose of moderate to vigorous physical activity. I think we need to eliminate the disparities across communities that exist. Over the last 2-3 years, I've gotten to know a guy in California by the name of Robert Garcia, and I'll tell you, I've fallen in love with this guy, but he's an attorney. He's a civil rights attorney, and I've heard him speak 3 or 4 times, and I think I just want to tape it and play it back. It makes me feel so good, but he's applying civil rights law to the disparities that exist across neighborhoods and communities with regard to resources that support physical activity. So it's parks and school grounds and he wins. He just does his lawyer thing and it works, when you think about it, why would we tolerate that? Why would we say, well, if you live on that side of the tracks, you got these nice facilities to support physical activity. You live over here, you don't. Well, he's figured out a way to win that battle, and I hope he's able to export it all over the country. I think we need to launch a sustained national social marketing campaign. Some of you will remember the Verb campaign, also known as the Youth Media campaign. I don't have time to tell the whole story, so I'll try to be quick about it. But there was a retiring congressperson, and this was at a time when Congress was sort of swimming in a lot of money, so it was well before the recession. And they asked him what he'd like as sort of a memorial when he was retiring from Congress. And he said, well, I'd like to fund a program on children's health. It was sort of a long meandering process from there, but a huge bolus of money came over to CDC in Atlanta, and they had to figure out what to do with it and went through a big planning process, and they decided, okay, we're going to do a national media campaign around physical activity in tweens, 12-year-olds. And, they had the resources to do it right. They segmented the market. They bought a bunch of time on Nickelodeon and the stations that kids that age watch. They leveraged it, so they only spent the money if the networks would match the time. And this was, these were not PSAs that ran at 3 a.m. This was prime time for kids viewing. And I was sort of around the edges of this thing with a group that was charged with sort of thinking about how to evaluate it. And I remember sitting there when I heard what they were going to do, thinking, there's not a snowball's chance this is going to do anything. Well, it did. I think about the best that you can evaluate it, which I think they did, it really seems to work. I came away sold. I think a really well-designed media campaign, social marketing effort could have a real effect. Now, I don't think you can do it for 2 weeks and accomplish anything, but I think if you really mounted a sustained social marketing campaign, there's reason to believe it could work, and the Verb campaign, I think, pretty well demonstrated that. I think we need to demand that every state adopt policies to ensure that young children are active while they're in childcare and preschool. And I don't have time to tell my whole story, but I think this is actually beginning to happen. How well the policies will translate into practice, we'll see. But I think there's sufficient concern about what's going on in childcare centers that states all over the country right now are revisiting their policies or creating new policies, and I think this is going to be a different picture over the next 3-4 years. And I think we need to ensure that community-based physical activity and sports programs are accessible to kids and provide them with adequate amounts of physical activity. You may have seen a paper that was published about a year ago where the San Diego group put accelerometers on kids in softball and soccer youth programs. And I actually spin their data differently than they spin it. The kids in the softball programs didn't get very much activity. I actually think the kids in the soccer programs got a meaningful dose of physical activity, but it, you know, certainly could be more. But you know, think about what an opportunity it is. I mean, we've got millions of kids in these programs, and you know, I think there's an opportunity there to better train the people, the adults that are supervising these programs, to try and ensure that. That there's some sensitivity to having the kids as active as possible. Just drives me crazy when I observe one of these programs and it's the traditional, you know, 15 kids and one ball and one kid with the ball and the other 14 stand around and watch that one kid. What a waste. It's like when I observe a PE class and, you know, the kids come in and they stand there waiting for somebody to take attendance for the first 10 minutes. You know, the default ought to be move, for crying out loud. You know, that should be the default. And if I need you to stop moving, I'll blow the whistle and let you know that. And then we can stop for a minute and I'll talk to you. But it's the other way around. The default is stand until somebody says move. And it just doesn't need to be that way. And I think it shouldn't. Let me summarize. I think there's adequate evidence to indicate that the 60-minute guideline, daily physical activity guideline for kids is reasonable. I think we've got evidence that not a lot of American kids are meeting that guideline at the present time. I think the short and long-term public health burden associated with that is very large. I worry about this generation of kids. And what this obesity epidemic is going to mean for them when they're 40 and 50 years old. It's not a pretty picture. If you've ever known anybody that had type 2 diabetes as a middle-aged adult, I'm sorry, it's not pretty. And I don't really think that we want to have to deal with millions and millions and millions of people that are struggling with that disease for a long, long time. So I think there are good reasons for us to be concerned about this. And I think that for all the value that our research products have, for us to change what's going on in our society, we're going to have to identify good policies and advocate effectively for them. I'm really honored to have been invited to speak with you this afternoon, and you've been a very attentive audience. Thank you very much.